show your support of them and your love for Lavonne. He was a fine man. He never attended many funerals in his life, precious few. I went with him on one or two of them. And I attributed that, he never told me this, but I attributed that to the fact that as an owner of nursing homes, he dealt with a lot of pain and suffering, and he saw death a lot. And he didn't like the sorrow attached to that. So he asked all of us, all of his family, that it be a festive occasion for his celebration of life, and that we wear bright clothing, and he even suggested we have beer and wine, but he was not a drinker, and when he said that, he told me that, and I thought to myself, golly, I've known him 44 years, and I've never seen him take a drink, but to my knowledge, there's no alcoholic beverages on the premises here, so we're here to gather to remember and honor his life, and there's going to be several people who are going to talk with you. I'm going to be one of them and show you my one experience with him that lasted for years, and I'm going to read a letter that his daughter Sandy wrote, and then his two granddaughters are also going to speak, as well as my wife, Frances. And just share with you some of the memories we had. He was the father of Sandy Murray, and she is married to Dale Murray. His grandchildren are Chelsea Cravey and her husband Andy. They were recently married. Unfortunately, Lavonne couldn't attend that because he was in the hospital at that time. He also had a brother, Lamar Mullis, and a sister, my wife, Frances Blacknall. He had stepchildren, too, that were in his life. Billy Anderson couldn't be with us today, Elaine Day, Corey Martin, and Brent Hupiana. And they grew up with Lavonne in his second marriage, and so they were important too to him throughout his life. He was the son of Leo Catfish Mullis. When I first moved here to Waycross in 1978, even though Catfish had died a few years before that, when I tell people who I was married to, they'd say, "Oh, that's Catfish's daughter," and Catfish's daughter. He worked on the farm, as I wrote the obituary and talked about his hard work on the farm, which really put him in a good upbringing for being having ethics and values and morals and hard work, and he carried that throughout his life. He never put on airs, though. Even though he was successful both as a farmer, as successful as you can be as a farmer, he told me that was some tough work. But he was the owner of three nursing homes with some other partners. And he made a success of that. But the success, the true success that I think Lavonne had, as I saw over the years, was with his family and his friends. He loved them, he excelled in his love of them, and they knew they could always depend on him for good advice, and he wouldn't throw money at them. He would figure out a way to solve the solution without a lot of expense being involved in that. He had a hearty laugh. When he laughed, and he would laugh. He and I kind of had a more serious relationship because of my education and being a lawyer, and him, you know, dealing with me in more serious matters. But we had many enjoyable times, and I'll share some of that with you later. It's difficult to sum up a lifetime of memories. I was in Lavonne's family for 44 years, and that's a long time, and a lot of memories are collected in that period of time. And of course, Lamar was with Lavonne longer, and Francis was there for a number of years. I'm not going to give away her age, but she'll tell you too what Lavonne meant to her as we try to sum up. It's hard to do it in a succinct manner, but we're going to try to and not cry if we can not cry, because he meant he meant a lot to all of us, and he meant a lot to his friends. We're going to, with that, we're going to have a musical tribute to him now, and followed by a letter from his daughter to him, and then I'm going to read, and then Courtney, his granddaughter, and Chelsea, his other granddaughter, are going to come and share their experiences with you.
Since you arrived. couch and a thermos full of coffee. It's another day in the dusty haze. Those burning rays are wearing down his body. The diesel's worth the price of gold. It's the cheapest grain he's ever sold. But he's still holding on. He just takes the tractor another round and pulls a plow across the ground and sends up another prayer. Says, Lord, I never complain, I never ask why. Please don't let my dreams run dry. Underneath this Amarillo sky. That hailstorm back in 83 sure did take a toll on his family. Stayed strong and carried on, just like his dad and granddad did before him. On his knees every night he prays, please let my crops and children grow, 'cause that's all he's ever known. He just takes the tractor another round and pulls a plow across the ground and sends up another. He says, Lord, I never complain, I never ask why. Please don't let my dreams run dry. Underneath this Amarillo sky. And he takes a tractor another round, another round, another round, and he takes a tractor another round, another round. He says, I never complain, I never ask why. Please don't let my dreams run dry. Underneath, underneath this Amarillo sky.
Sandy has asked that I read a letter that she would direct to her father. As you can imagine, it's not much festivity about that. And so I'm going to be direct with it and may bring a tear, may even bring a tear as I read it. Dear Daddy, you are the most amazing man any daughter could ever be blessed to have. You are my world, my girl's world, and we need you and your advice each and every day. My girls and I have had the most inspirational role model anybody could ever have. We look up to you and your wisdom. We live our lives to the best of your expectations. We have pushed and strived in all that we do to make you proud. I truly hope that we have done that in your eyes. You have left so many life lessons for all of us, and I promise I will always remember them and try to continue as many as I can during my life. I love you so much, Daddy. At this time, I'd like to ask Courtney and Chelsea to come to the podium to share their experiences with their grandfather. Both of you want to come up here, that's fine.
Thank you. the best things in life aren't things, they're moments. And the moments spent with Papa were truly some of the greatest and most impactful moments of my life. Papa held a special spot in the hearts of many and served numerous roles throughout his lifetime. Most may know Papa to be my grandfather, but to me, he was much more. He was my best friend. There's no bond more sacred than one shared with a best friend, and there's no best friend better than a Papa. He is and always will be my person, my voice of reason, the best source of advice, my role model. Okay. My confidant, my secret keeper, best friend, my everything. He taught me how to love in the fullest capacity and the purest form, because he showed me and loved me day in and day out just the same. Love radiates off of him, especially when he's surrounded by his great grandpups. The moment Sammy ran into Great Papa, his eyes would light up, a smile would engulf his face, and you could feel the overwhelming sense of happiness, joy, and love. Sammy's love language is food and playtime, and no one knew how to speak it better than Papa. A visit to Papa's house, always in shirt, a rotisserie chicken, picked out and saved just for Sammy, and a basket of balls for him to play with. Teaching how to love is just the tip of the iceberg whenever it comes to all the knowledge and life lessons Papa provided me with. He led by example and instilled a work ethic comparable to no other. He taught me how to work hard and take pride in what I've worked for, to always prepare and be ready for any twists, turns, or curveballs life throws your way. And even though hard work and preparation are key, it's equally as important to never take life too seriously. I knew even on my worst days, I could count on him for a laugh and to always put small worries into perspective. He had faith in me, even whenever I didn't have it in myself. He picked me up from my lowest of lows and cheered me on during my highest of highs. Papa was the best of best at countless things, the best storyteller. He could tell a story like it just happened yesterday, and he had the ability to make you feel like you were there with him and part of the storyline. He had the best sense of humor and always knew how to make a story take a funny turn. He would make you laugh harder than you ever have in your life, but the best part of it all was being able to hear his laugh. His sweet laugh would light up a whole room and fill everyone with a sense of joy. He's the best at giving advice, and the one you can always count on to have an answer or a solution to any question or problem you may have. He didn't simply solve the problem for you, but he helped guide you into forming your own solution and following it through. He's also the best person to have on your side, and the one you can always count on to have your back. Growing up, it was a natural feeling for Papa to have my back, and in turn, I always had his. I loved being sneaky together. From keeping little secrets and sneaking tobacco into hospitals and doctor's appointments, I'll never forget the adrenaline rush associated with both. The thrill of guarding the door and blocking the window to keep the nurses from seeing him put the tobacco in, and thinking of random questions to ask to stall them from coming in while he got rid of the evidence. They had no clue, and we always giggled so hard when they left. My heart starts racing to this day whenever I think about those sneaky little moments. Now let's talk about the really good stuff, the food. Papa was the best cook, but the hardest person to follow a recipe from, because he always measured with his heart, adding some of this and some of that until it tasted just right. And who knows, the recipe could have needed some tweaking, and the ingredients may have a slight variation next time. Regardless of the recipe, each dish that Papa made was guaranteed to be a family favorite and the most sought-after dish at all of the get-togethers. Speaking of family, that was the center of his world. He always put family first through it all and loved us each unconditionally. Papa, summarizing your impact on my life is truly an impossible task, because your impact is endless and something I will carry with me forever. I'm honored to have been able to spend almost 27 full years by your side and have shared countless special and precious moments with you. Your memory will never fade. I will always have you with me, because you're the one who helped mold me into the woman I am today. You're larger than life, Papa, and I can't wait to chase you down as fast as Sammy chases down his tennis balls and jump in your arms, embracing you with the biggest hug you've ever felt. You better be ready, because I'll be running straight to you.
There's so many memories and good times Papa and I had together. And if I had to write them down, we'd be here for the next month. Papa was a humble man and never wanted to be the center of attention in life and now in death. He wouldn't want us to focus on him or the sadness of his death, but instead focus on the happiness in our lives and the good times that we had with him. Papa lived a life full of joy and happiness. Every time I think about him, I think about how humorous, witty, and clever he was. Most of my childhood memories with him are tinged with traces of humor and laughter. It was so much fun to be with him. I'll miss all of the Friday night dinner. Dinner and Walmart trip dates that we crashed. He loved to laugh and have fun, and I adored every ounce of his being. Every time I went to visit him on Sundays, he would tell me all of his childhood memories and stories. And not only did he teach me so many valuable lessons, he amazed me with all of the things he accomplished. He was such an extraordinary man who had an extraordinary life. Looking back, now I realize it was not the events in his life that were extraordinary, but the way he faced them. He faced life with intelligence and courage. Papa always said that the love he had for Chelsea and I was different than any other love. He always said he could spoil us and then send us back to Mama and Daddy. He never got on to us for anything and never scolded us, just taught us so many life lessons. And we knew better than to do anything to disappoint him. He was selfless and kind, and he loved being a parent and a papa. It was truly his calling in life. Papa, I will always miss you. 23 years is not nearly enough, but I have so many wonderful memories to hang on to that I'm thankful for. You are a role model and a best friend. Your guidance and love will carry me through to the end of my days. I love you, Papa, until we meet again.
At this time, we're going to have another song played.
Wish every porch had a swing. Wish kids still learned to say sir and ma'am, how to shake a hand. I wish every state had a Birmingham. I wish everybody knew all the words to Mama tried. I wish Monday mornings felt just like Friday nights. And I wish even cars had truck beds. And every road was named Copperhead. And coolers never run out of cold Bud Light. And I wish high school home teams never lost. And back road drinking kids never got caught. And I wish the price of gas was low. And cotton was high. I wish honky-tonks didn't have no closing time. And I wish grandpas never died. I wish Sundays on the creek bank would never end. Wish I could learn to drive again. Wish the first time 17 she was my everything. Kiss in a Chevrolet could happen every day. I wish everybody overseas was gonna make it home. I wish country music still got played on country radio. And I wish even cars had truck beds. And every road got
wish farms never got sold. And I wish even cars had truck beds, and every road was named Copperhead, and coolers never run out of cobalt light. I wish high school home teams never lost, and back road drinking kids never got caught. And I wish the price of gas was low and cotton was high. And I wish honky tonks didn't have no clothes and time. And I wish grandpas never died. I wish grandpas never died.
Now I'd like to invite my wife, Lavonne's sister, Frances, to come share some thoughts with you. And then I'm going to also share a few with you.
Well, I'm going to try not to get emotional, but, you know, I'm not going to guarantee that. Lavonne and I spent a lot of time together, particularly over the last 10 years or so, because he had so many medical issues that were going on. But, you know, he was always full of laughter, jokes, and stories. You heard the girls talk about that. But that was just Lavonne. He always had something to say. He always loved on Saturdays going to Pearson. So he and Jimmy and Harry could hang out and share stories until he got to the point where he couldn't hear. And then it became so difficult that he had to sort of slow back on that. But he was just full of laughter, jokes, and stories. But he had one fault. He was not a patient man. He was not patient. And he was always on time or early for wherever he was going. And he expected you to at least be on time. And there was a time a few years back that he was going down to Jacksonville to a specialist down there because of his back. Always had back problems, had multiple surgeries on his back. But he was going down there, and they had set him up for this procedure that was going to require the use of a surgical room down there. And he went for the, I'm going to call it the pre-op visit, you know, before the procedure. And when he got there, of course, he was on time. When he got there, he had to wait over an hour to be able to see the doctor. Unfortunately, he was able to see the doctor talking to the staff and laughing and carrying on. Well, you can imagine Lavonne Mullis and how that little Mullis temper of his got reared up a little bit. But he was an unhappy camper, so he was going to pay the doctor back, going to pay him back. So when it was time to come back for the procedure a week or so later, he decided, well, I'm just going to stop in there at Cedar River. And I'm going to have me a lunch. And he casually ate that lunch. And he knew when he was supposed to have been there. But he ate that lunch just slowly. And he finally got to the office and meandered in there. And they were all in an uproar because they already had the room reserved for his procedure. But, you know, he just meandered in there and he told them why. His time was just as important as that doctor, and that doctor should have seen him on time at the time when he went before. Now, Lavonne was a tobacco-chewing fool. I mean, it didn't matter with him. He always had his tobacco in his pocket, and he had these nasty red cups, spit cups, that he always took with him everywhere. And he was very, very sneaky about it, like Chelsea was talking about. She was a secret keeper from the nurses and doctors in the hospital because Lavonne prepared for his hospital visit. He took a Lysol wipe. That was his spit cup. Yes, that was his spit cup in the hospital, in CCU. And he had his tobacco packs that we had to keep replenishing. You know, everybody hunting all over Jacksonville to try to find that particular tobacco that he chewed. But he had a technique, though. He had a technique that he could watch, make sure when the nurses were coming in or the doctors were coming in. He always had the tissue right by his side so that when they came in, he just acted like he was wiping his nose and wiping his mouth, and he was getting the tobacco out of his mouth, you know, and throwing it away so they wouldn't know. But I think what happened is I think they probably saw, you know, how sometimes tobacco juice gets here. You know, I think they may have seen that because they did search his room to be able to find where the tobacco was, and they could never find his hiding place. So Chelsea helped out with that quite a bit. But he had a huge, huge heart, and many of you here, or most of you here, probably all of you here, have been the recipient of that big, big heart of his. But he also used it to his advantage, too. Last year took all of the year for him to get a new set of teeth. And that was visit after visit after visit over in Brunswick, getting his mouth prepared and whatnot. And it was when he started going, it was about when the tomatoes came in, and Moore's Farms, you know, had their tomatoes, and everybody loves their tomatoes. He loaded up his truck with, I don't know, Moni, you can tell me how many cartons and crates of tomatoes that he would take over to the dentist office for the girls in the office. So you can imagine the special treatment that he got every time he walked in. It was, hey, Mr. Mullis, hey, Mr. Mullis, you know. But he got that special treatment, so he knew how to use that big heart. And I could go on and on and on about stories about his colorful life and why I love my brother so much. But I'm going to close for now and save those for later.
I came into the Mullis family about 44 years ago. He joked with me several times over the years that he wouldn't be married to a Mullis. And I kind of came to appreciate that over the years. He was an easy man to be around when I met him. He was not pretentious or overbearing. We immediately hit it off. I listened to him and talked with him initially as we got to know each other, and the bond he had with his sister was a good bridge for me and him. He talked with me a lot about the farming business and the nursing business. He was a part owner, as I said earlier, in three different nursing homes. And I was a young lawyer just getting started, but he respected me for my education, and I respected him for his business acumen. He was very successful in the nursing home business, and successful too as a farmer. As he talked with me about the nursing home, though, I became aware that his first love was really farming, and even working on the equipment. He would complain about this piece of equipment that had broken, and he had to go to Pearson or Douglas or somewhere to get a piece, and later on was sending money to get those pieces and getting that equipment fixed. It seemed like there was always something broken on a piece of equipment in a farm. He got me into the farming business one time when Francis and I built a house about 22 years ago. He came to the property and showed up, I believe, Lamar Davis had a tractor trailer that had had a big enough bed on it that he showed up with a bulldozer and other farm equipment, and he cleared our land for us to be able to build a house. And after we got that house built, his mother moved in with me and Francis, and I think it took some prodding from his mom, not much, but also from his sister to have a garden built or plowed and set up in our back, I used to call it the back 40. That's an exaggeration. It was only about an acre or so. But after he got that doggone thing planted, and I had to get out there and hoe it, and we had to drag a water hose from, you know, three miles out there to where it was, because we didn't have any irrigation system. After all, it was just a little old garden. But we did that, and he talked me into buying a tractor. He found me a tractor, and he said, you need to have this tractor out there. And I hadn't quite gotten out of the garden business at that point in time. So he showed up with a tractor, and I bought it from him. And then as we got to doing a little bit more with that little old garden, he said, you know, they got sales over there in Moultrie. And he was talking about auctions of farm equipment, things like that. He said, you need to go over to Moultrie with me on one Wednesday. They have them on Wednesdays. I can't remember if it was the third week of the month or whatever. But I wanted a break from my business. And so I said, yeah, I'll go with you sometime. And so we went over there and he said, now you need to get you some harrows. And so I said, okay, Lavonne, if you think I need some harrows, we'll get me some harrows. And so we got some harrows, and said, you need a little planter too, something that'll, you know, get the rows of the garden going. I said, all right, we'll do that too. And so, you know, with time, over the space of about a year and a year and a half, maybe even 2 years, I'd accumulated a grooming mower, a bush hog, a bucket that I could move some sand with and things like that, and I didn't have any real use for that. We got, did I mention the rake a minute ago? We got the rake, the bucket, the grooming mower, the bush hog, and it started accumulating back there. It was beginning to look like his farm with a lot of used equipment and no good equipment, because to tell you the truth, and the harrows too, you know, it got out there. By the end of the time that he and I had been to Moultrie several times over two or three or four years, I had two grooming mowers and two bush hogs in addition to the other equipment, none of which I use today. And as a matter of fact, I need to probably find out if they're still in business and take some of that back over there and sell it to them. But what I enjoyed about that was my opportunity to be with him, and I looked forward to those Wednesdays going to Moultrie with them, because we would ride over there, and that would take a good hour and a half, and we spent all morning looking through all of the equipment they had, and he'd see things that he needed and stuff like that. And I learned in the course of my time with him that there was equipment he had already bought. Now, he was a frugal man and a smart man, but he'd buy this used equipment. And one day he pointed out over there that a trailer that he'd bought, and I looked over at it and I saw the date on it, and I said, Lavonne, this thing's about 10 years old. And he said, yeah, I just hadn't had time or the inclination or whatever to pick it up, but they'll keep it for me. And So yeah, and I think it's still there today. The last time he and I went, he never picked it up. We would also, though, after we were there in the morning and going through all of that, he'd say, let's go get us a bite to eat. And we'd go to a restaurant there. I can't even remember the name of it, but it was a buffet. And he would, even though he was kind of always watching his diet a little bit, he liked fat back. And he'd get that fat back, and I'd start getting it too. And he'd gum it to death, and I'd chomp on it like a beaver on wood, you know. I loved it too. And then of course we might run back to the cell for a few minutes and look and see what else was there, and then we'd head on back. And even as good as I love food, as I said a minute ago, the best time I had with Lavonne was being with him traveling over there and talking with him about farming and other matters, and then coming back. He had a good heart. He helped anyone that needed help. And I loved him. When he came to live with us with the hospice thing a few weeks ago, I told him, I said, Lavonne, I love you. He said, I like you too. So with that, we're going to have another song. It's going to be, I believe it's By Dirt. And as I said, he really loved farming. I think that was his first love. But he loved people. And it was really good to have the number of years I had with him and to be a part of his life. So that's the next song. And then we're going to close with memories. Other than I am going to ask if any of y'all, after my daughter and mine and Francis's daughter Kristy comes up and speak with you, I'm going to ask if anybody would like to share an anecdote or a special memory with Lavonne. But we're going to have Kristy come in after this song.
A few days before he turned 80, he was sitting out back in a rocker. He said, what you been up to lately? I told him, chasing a dollar. And in between sips of coffee, he poured this wisdom out. Said, if you want my 2 cents on making a dollar count, buy dirt, find the one you can't live without. Get a ring, let your knee hit the ground. Do what you love, but call it work. Throw a little money in the plate at church. Send your prayers up and your roots down deep. Add a few limbs to your family tree. And watch their pencil marks in the grass in the yard all grow up. Cause the truth about it is, it all goes by real quick. You can't buy happiness, but you can buy dirt.
Caught on that ladder, let me tell you what it's all about. Find you a few things that matter that you can put a fence around. And then he laid it out. Buy dirt, find the one you can't live without. Get a ring, let your knee hit the ground. Do what you love, but call it work. And throw a little money in the plate at church. Send your prayers up and your roots down deep. And add a few limbs to your family tree. And watch their pencil marks in the grass in the yard all grow up. Cause the truth about it is, it all goes by real quick. You can't buy happiness, but you can buy dirt.
You can buy dirt. Thank the good Lord for it,
cause he ain't making any more of it.
So buy dirt,
find the one you can't live without.
Get a ring, let your knee hit the ground.
do what you love, but call it work. And throw a little money in the plate at church. Send your prayers up and your roots down deep. Add a few limbs to your family tree. Watch their pencil marks in the grass in the yard all grow up. Cause the truth about it is, it all goes by real quick. You can't buy happiness, but you can buy dirt.
Hi, my name's Kristy, and I'm Uncle Lavonne's favorite niece. But it wasn't until yesterday that I realized that I was his only niece. And that really never registered with me, because over the years, I've heard many people refer to him as Uncle Lavonne or Papa Lavonne. And that is because, as his granddaughter Chelsea said earlier, he has a special place in the hearts of many. That song was very fitting, and he's taught us a lot of lessons, but one thing that he did teach is, one, buy dirt, second, dig a pond. He, if there was dirt, he was gonna be digging. He loved to dig, and every piece of dirt needs a pond. Pond provides three major things: a swimming hole, a source of food, fish, and irrigation for the crops. Although Uncle Lavonne was my uncle, he was much more than that to me. I was so fortunate to be able to spend a lot of my time growing up at his house in Millwood. Uncle Lavonne hung the moon in my eyes from childhood to this day. His opinion on everything is what mattered the most, when most of everybody else's opinion did not matter to me. One thing he taught us, that you have to work hard to play hard. And boy, oh boy, did Uncle Vaughn work hard, and he had lots of toys. One of my favorite jobs was to try to help Miss Betty around the house, and I loved Miss Betty. Hard work pays off, so I was sweeping in the den while Uncle Vaughn was sitting in his recliner puffing on cigarettes. All of a sudden, he jumps out of the chair, and real loudly he said, "Watch out, the floor's on fire." Scared me to death. I said, "What? How? What's wrong?" He said, "You're sweeping that floor so fast, you're gonna catch it on fire." I said, then he lets out his unforgettable laugh. Another thing he taught us was to be kind to others. And I remember these two men named Pop and Slim that helped years ago on the farm in Tobacco. And they didn't have transportation of their own, and so they had to be picked up for work each day. They wanted a vehicle. And as many of us know, he would get us what we wanted. Maybe not the exact thing we had in mind, but that's where his jokester personality came in. He bought a vehicle for them, Pops and Slim, to share, and had it proudly sitting in the yard. And he laughed so much about this. He could hardly wait to see the excitement on their faces when he showed them. It was a hearse. He got a good deal on it, and he even got a good deal on the casket that came with it. Pop and Slim, they were scared. They didn't even want to stand near it. They were like, "Oh, Mr. Mullis, we can't drive that, Mr. Mullis. We can't drive that." But they did drive it, with the exception that the casket could not stay in the vehicle. So it did stay on the ground for, I can't even remember how long, but it was there for a long time. Another thing he taught us was, when you get lemons, you make lemonade. And when Sandy turned 16 or 17, I'm not sure, but whenever she got her license, he bought her a beautiful sky blue Maverick with no air conditioning, except the faster you go, the more air you would get. Roll down windows, and sometimes we had to roll up and pull up if we wanted to close them. No radio, and dual exhaust, or what I thought sounded like dual exhaust, but I think it was a bad muffler. But it had a motor and wheels. And that was a funny test to see, for him to see how Sandy would turn those lemons into lemonade. And Sandy was drinking lemonade out of the driveway, honey. Boombox with D-sized batteries in the front seat, her personal DJ riding shotgun, and that good old towel to wipe down the windshield and windows when the car fogged up from us breathing. Let the good times roll. I asked Uncle Lavonne for a Corvette for Christmas. That's all I wanted, Uncle Vaughn. And he came through as usual. I got that Corvette in a box from Walmart, and I had to put it together. But I got to drink lemonade while I looked at it on the shelf. Some rules are made to be broken. I followed that one good. But it was in 2020 on the way to Jacksonville to see him in the hospital that he called and he said, hey, I need you to pick up some tobacco on the way. And I thought, oh my God, I was so scared because that I was gonna be smuggling tobacco and I didn't want to get in trouble. But we stopped at so many stores trying to find Levi Garrett. We finally found the treasure. And when I got to Uncle Lavonne's room, he said, put it over there in that bag. Well, the bag was full of tobacco. And I said, Uncle Lavonne, you have so much tobacco. He said, yeah, I just don't want to run out. The quickest way to get Uncle Lavonne out of the back door of the house was to get the Mormon missionaries at the front door. He was always kind and polite, always welcomed them in their home, in his home. But he would announce to Sandy or Aunt Barbara when they were married years ago that she had a visitor. There were so many stories, memories, and life lessons that he has taught us. But the most important one was the one he told us at the end, at the hospital in Jacksonville. And Uncle Vaughn saved the best for last. On Wednesday, July 20th, I received a phone call from my mom with the horrible reality concerning Uncle Vaughn's future. I drove down that day to Jacksonville to be with Uncle Lavonne, Sandy, and the girls. All the way down I-95, I cried. I listened to Alan Jackson's Precious Memories album, and I prayed. Although Uncle Lavonne had never been verbal about religion, heaven, and hell, or Jesus around me, I knew he questioned things. I wanted to talk to Uncle Lavonne about it, but time was running out. And I was so scared, I was scared to death to talk to him because he was not the easiest person to talk to about certain subjects. And I didn't want to make him angry or upset, and I didn't want to get cussed out. And I just would say, what do I do? How do I start a conversation to actually see what he believed? I never had to do a thing. He took care of it all. As I was walking down the hall to his room, Chelsea was ending a telephone call. She said, Papa wants to talk to a Catholic priest. I think he wants to confess some things. We have called several, she and Chelsea, or Chelsea and Courtney called several priests and had to leave messages. Father Jason was the one on the telephone with Chelsea, and he was on his way. He and Uncle Lavonne had a long time while we waited by the hospital room door. We were all shocked and full of happy tears. Father Jason left, and Uncle Lavonne was different. He was calm. His anxiety had left. He was mentally alert. And we had multiple conversations with all together. One of them was him sharing how to cook some of his favorite recipes, step by step, and we actually recorded that. Courtney and Chelsea left to get supper before taking the night shift beside their papa. Sandy and I were there with Uncle Lavonne talking and soaking up every second. He sometimes would get aggravated if you talk too much. So Sandy said, "Daddy, do you want us to quit talking so much so you can get some rest?" In the sweetest, calmest, most contented voice, he said, "No, I want to talk to you." And this is what he slowly said. "There's stages of life. When you're young, you hear about them and you see them in life and you see it on TV, but you don't believe it. It's not until you're dying that you know there is hell and there is heaven, and it is real. Find a good church so you can live." I don't know how many times he told the four of us to go to church. And we asked him, "Well, what church did we go to?" And I said, "Do we need to go to a Baptist church?" And he said, "Try a Catholic or a Mormon church." And he was very verbal about the Mormon church being his first choice to try. "But go to a good church." There's this lyric of a song that says, "I can't quote the book, the chapter, or the verse, but you can't tell me that it all ends in a slow ride in a hearse." I know that's not all that there is, and so does Uncle Lavonne. "We're going to stroll over heaven with you, Uncle Lavonne, and until then, we will be going to church."
And we're going to have a final song, after which, as I said earlier, if anybody wanted to share their particular memories or anecdotes or anything with their experience with Lavonne, they'd be welcome to come up to the open mic we have. But the song is "I Want to Stroll Over Heaven with You."
If I surveyed all the good things that come to me from above, if I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of Him beyond mortal king, and I'm sure that He'd grant it. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. So many places of beauty we long to see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew while I stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away.
then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you.
If anybody would like to have a comment about Lavonne or share an anecdote or an experience you've had with him, you're welcome to come up here, and we set up a mic. So if you would like to do that, you can feel free to come on up. Ms. Betty.
Hello, everyone. I don't need a mic. I just have Zoom, so I hope it's running. To the family, I know this is a hard time, and my funniest story was I had never cooked rabbits. And he wanted me to fry rabbits one day, and I said, I don't know nothing about wildlife. He said, well, you do it just like you do chicken. So when I finished it, he ate it, so I guess it must have been good. Because he bought some more for me to do later on. But I just want to say to the family, I am so tickled to death to hear the last part of what he had said about go to church somewhere. Because you can preach to the living, but you can't talk to the dead. They've lived their life. It may not have been exactly the way he wanted to live it, or we wanted to live it, but once you get that understanding of God and knowledge in your heart and your mind, and it's like I tell people, before I got saved, I used to be the quietest thing in the church, now I'm the loudest. But I said, I thank God for the people that I have met over the years. And that includes my extended family. And I love each and every one of you all from my heart, not my lips. I always say, if I don't love you from my heart, I'm not going to tell you I love you. And my other baby back there can tell you, she brings me vegetables every year. And now her baby's got her, they're going to come to my house. I feel like I said, bring them anytime they will come, bring them. And I'm talking about Kayla. She was a little Vaughn's other granddaughter.
Need some buddies.
Huh? You can say, go ahead.
I've been to some buddies. We got some buddies at home.
He always lets me know what they have. I said, you all don't understand what I feel like in my heart to know that you all love me as good as I love you all. And my baby over there, when I saw her at Barbara's funeral, I thought she had forgotten me, but she hadn't. And then I said, you know, it's just the impact that people have on your life, you don't never think about it then. But as you get older, and trust me, I'm getting there. And I just want to say to Sandy, Dale, everybody, y'all just keep your head up, keep them in your heart, because you're going to always remember. Remember the good things, and especially the last part, encouraging you to go to church somewhere. It doesn't matter where you go. As long as you feel God in your heart, and you're satisfied, and you're comfortable, that's where you go. It doesn't matter what religion you are, there's only one God. And that's what we're going to, you know, a lot of people think they're seven, but they're in for a rude awakening. We all serve the same God. And I just want you all to know, I'm here. You need me. I'll be calling to check on you. So look forward. And I love you all.
Thank you, Miss Betty. Is there any other comments or thoughts? Okay, well then at this time, we'll close. We want to thank you, each of you, for coming and showing your love and support of Lavonne and the family. And we just pray that God be with you as you go through your life. And I think heed those words of Lavonne's at the end. So with that, we'll close. Thank you again.